Good evening and welcome to the March 20th, 2017 regularly scheduled Midland Public School Board of Education meeting. At this time, if everyone would please turn off their cell phones. We get interference with our TV feed from cell phones. And if you would all stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, Scott, if you would do roll call, please.
Certainly. President Branstad.
Here.
Vice President Singer.
Here.
Treasurer Frazee.
Here.
Member Baker.
Here.
Member Blasey.
Here.
Member Fidel.
Here.
All present and accounted for.
All right, excellent. Moving into item two, which is our consent agenda. 2.1 is approval of the minutes from the February 20th regular meeting. 2.2 is the following person recommended for employment. 2.3 are staff members who have announced their resignation with their effective dates. 2.4 is approval of the 2017 summer wage rates for teachers employed for summer school, curricular study, and other extended services. 2.5 is the administration recommending the renewal of the food service contract with Chartwell's for the 2017-18 school year. And just to point out, this is the third renewal of our five-year contract that we have. 2.6 is approval of payment of the school system's bills for the month of February. And 2.7 are legal invoices for payment. This time, I would entertain a motion.
I'll move to adopt the items listed in the consent agenda.
Support.
Okay, moved by Scott, supported by Mary. Is there any discussion?
No, other than Caitlin Schnur was my little Girl Scout.
Well, I'm glad she's employed now.
Yeah. All right, any other discussion? All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? All right, the consent agenda passes. Moving into item three, March Shining Stars.
We're going to start off with Judy Wisnowski. Judy would come forward. I'll read a little bit all about Judy as she comes up. Judy began her employment with Midland Public Schools in 1980 as a paraprofessional at Cook Elementary School. Through the years, her professional assignments have included noon hour supervision, reading aid, special education, chapter one, title one, classroom para, library, and much more. Judy's current assignment is in the media center at paraprofessional at Woodcrest. Judy was nominated for the Shining Star by an MPS staff member. Among their comments were the following. Judy is the Woodcrest Media Center paraprofessional. She tirelessly approaches the numerous responsibilities associated with maintaining a highly effective media center with a positive attitude, whether it is helping a student locate information or gathering materials for a teacher to help with a unit. Judy does it all with a smile on her face. She visits classrooms to explain the accelerated reader program, assists with computer problems, maintains the makerspace, and solicits volunteers to help in the media center. Judy creates and maintains an atmosphere conducive to student learning, which results in many students and groups using the media center throughout each day. Later in the this evening's meeting, you'll be recognizing Judy's retirement. Judy will leave us in June with 38 years of dedicated service to the students and staff at Midland Public Schools. Congratulations, Judy. Second Shining Star is Laura Hallberg. Laura would come forward. We'll read a little bit about Laura. She comes up. Ms. Hallberg joined the Midland Public School staff in 1998. She has been a counselor at both Midland High and H.H. Dow High during her almost 20 years with MPS. Laura earned her bachelor's degree from Western Michigan University in 1991 and her master's degree from Central Michigan University in 1996. Laura was nominated for the Shining Star by a Dow High parent. Among the comments were the following. For 3 years, Laura Hallberg has been a wonderful resource in helping my daughter, who entered Dow High from a non-MPS school. She counseled her for weeks through whether or not to continue with a hard math class, guided her through course selection when she was uncertain of the best fit, communicated necessary information on standardized testing, and has set college preparation steps to keep parents aware of college visits and financial aid. She responds very quickly to emails when we need her insight. Most importantly, my daughter trusts Mrs. Hallberg and is very comfortable with her. There are many caring teachers at HH Dow High, and the continuance of having a knowledgeable counselor looking out for our students from year to year is another MPS plus that may get overlooked. Congratulations, Laura.
Thanks, Laura.
Congratulations, Laura. Thank you.
Thank you. You do a wonderful job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, moving into 3.2, Adams and Woodcrest.
We have Mr. Fenix and Linda introduce everybody.
Sure.
Start it off or whatever you're going to do.
You'll have to, this will be for television's sake, correct?
Yeah, come forward if I need to.
All right, guys. I think we want to see everyone here. All right, well, thank you very much for the opportunity to come and make the presentation this evening. We have Linda Lipset, of course, from Adams. Kim McMahon, Spanish from Adams. Robin Harshman-Rogers is our PYP coordinator at Woodcrest and Adams. Wendy LaCourt is our PE teacher at Woodcrest. And Jenna Lude is art at Adams. And Sarah Haskett is music at Adams. And this group here, As you know, we're in our fourth year of being an authorized, I should say first year of being authorized as a PYP school, fourth year of the program. We thought it would be wise this evening to help you understand how the program has changed, what goes on in the auxiliaries. We know, of course, rightfully so, the core, common core, the four core, excuse me, I should say, get much of the attention with M-STEP testing, reading scores, math scores, all those things that unquestionably are very, very important. But the auxiliary classes have been transformed as well by the PYP philosophies. I would say that they have a rather unique and difficult job making that transformation in the sense that depending on the auxiliary, they may see the students once a week or at maximum twice a week. And compared to a classroom teacher, they see every single student in the building. Sixth grade levels. So they've done a very nice job of incorporating PYP philosophies into their program, and we thought it would be wise to kind of give you an overview of how things have changed in their world since we have been authorized and been involved with the PYP program. So with that, we'll turn it over to Robin.
All right, good evening. I'm Robin Harshman-Rogers. I'm the PYP coordinator at both Adams and Woodcrest this year. And we're here to talk a little bit about our auxiliaries, or specialists as they're called in the PYP. So, you can go another one, thank you. So we began 4 years ago with everyone, and teachers had to write 6 units, and they were busy doing that. And the auxiliaries kind of were waiting and waiting and waiting for when is our time to jump in. And we're very patient and started building with the learner profile and the essential elements in their classrooms. And then they began to have a time where they got together, both phase one and phase two schools, to start writing their own planners. So now that we are IB World PYP schools, one of the things that we do have to have done by the time they visit again in 5 years is a unit from each auxiliary. So they have started that. They've also, I'd say, made some really rich connections that they're going to share with you here tonight. And we have called this not only for our teachers, but for our auxiliaries or specialists, a year of growth. Because we've been authorized and now we're just growing with what we've built. We're refining our units of inquiry and just continuing to grow. So they are the stars tonight, not me. I'm on the sidelines tonight coaching them. So first we have Wendy LaCourt gonna talk about physical education.
Good evening. For me, the PYP journey for me really starts with the essential agreement, which are is one. It actually solves a lot of things for me in the gym. One, the things that they asked us to do is to make thinking visible, which can be difficult in a more physical class. So we actually have our essential agreement that is created by the students. They discuss what being safe, responsible, and respectful is. They put their thoughts, and then we hang these up all year. So when you have a student who is not being safe, you can say, what does our essential agreement say? Are you being safe? No. Then that's the end of discussion. There is no more discussion. It really helps to create accountability. It also gives us a common language with all of the classes because everybody has an essential agreement. So when you say, what does the essential agreement say? They know what that is. We were asked to make connections, and some of the connections that we've made in the gym with our kindergarten unit of forces. We did a Fun with Forces Day where they used equipment that they've used in gym, but we used it forcefully and tied to the forces unit that they did in the classroom. We also have expressing yourself creatively through art, and our kindergartners, we have a week of dancing, getting ready for our big sock hop, and so we're able to, you know, make that connection. Also, with the fifth grade, they have to write goals, and we write goals, and which actually is what the way our unit actually starts is with writing goals. And so they make that connection. They see goal writing in an academic setting, and they see it maybe that's going to a goal for them physically. one of the things that they said to us in the very beginning was, find ways that this fits naturally with what you do. Don't change what you already do. So, you know, in the beginning, you're kind of like, okay, all right, I'm not sure. But then last year, it started with floor hockey, because I can't safely give 25 kids hockey sticks and have them go all over the gym with a puck and sticks. So half of them play at a time. We have a little floor hockey tournament. And half of them are sitting there watching their friends play. What a perfect time to reflect on what's going on in floor hockey. So this was what we started, also, you know, made our thinking visible. And then it's just evolved. We had Paddleton reflection, and then in volleyball, we reflect as a team. We have team meetings. We set goals for the game. We set goals for the day, something besides winning. And that has then given me courage, and I've actually been able to do team meetings with kindergartners and different activities. So it's really just an evolution. It's amazing to me how in 3.5 years how my teaching has changed for the better using the PYP philosophies. It elevates student-to-student talk. It really, the conversation is between the kids, you know, serving. Mrs. LaCourte can tell you how to serve, and Mrs. LaCourte could try to affix you, but if they get into a team meeting and they're sharing how to fix your serve, it just has more meaning, and it's elevated how, you know, even their play. One of the big things that we did, these are some of my other connections. This is team meetings in volleyball, and this is actually my pull-up bar. And when they're doing the flexed arm hang, which they hang on a bar for, some of them hang 1 to 2 minutes, actually, and this gives them something to look at and actually draw global connections. So last year I put up the Detroit Tigers roster and it has where they're from. And so then they could actually, as they're hanging, kind of see where is Caracas, Venezuela, where's, you know, Texas or whatever. So they actually, you know, it was just a way to tie it in a PE way. another thing that I did was we created a field day that has a global connection. We call it the Amazing Race. And every game is tied globally, and yet is still a field day game. So for example, this one up here is the Egyptian rivalry, because it was believed that the Egyptians were the first ones to create tools to make rope. This is actually the Grecian pursuit, where, you know, because most languages are tied to the Greek alphabet. So it's a journey around the globe, and we finish it off with reflection, and it's a great field day, and we were able to tie it to a PYP. And this is where we're going. We are, we've written our unit. We're unpacking it this year with full plans to implement it in the fall, and it does start with writing a goal for fitness testing. and it will be actually, our unit will start in the fall and will carry through to the end of the year because we fitness test twice. And they're going to write goals and evaluate their, you know, how they did the first time and hopefully make a better goal. So that is what is in our PYP gym bag. And now I'm going to turn it over to Art, I think.
All right. I would just like to share a little bit how my teaching has changed. And I have brought a little example of our paper mache unit that we just got finished with. And we especially looked at, excuse me, color for our inquiry project. So they, all the fourth graders made crayons, and we talked about what a 3D project is and how the logistics of that. Before PYP and thinking this way, I probably would have set out a bunch of paint pre-made for the kids and said, pick your favorite color. But since now that we are in PYP, I put a little bit more thinking into how I present or give kids choices. So this was during our How We Express Ourselves theme, or unit, excuse me. So the line that I wanted the kids to especially think about is how color choice can be a form of expression for them. So what we did is we kind of made those paper mache crayons, and they were super excited to paint them. And the next day they all came in and they were saying, we're painting them, right? And I said, actually, we're going to talk about color for a little bit. And they were awesome. But we looked at a book real quick about, it's called Why is the Blue Dog Blue? And it talked about why artists choose certain colors based on their previous experiences and and about their emotions or different things that have affected them. And then we played a little paint chip game. They got to look at paint chips and associate those experiences with color. Which was a lot of fun, and the kids found similarities. Some of them, you know, found certain colors linking to certain experiences and emotion, which we all recorded in our journals, which was an awesome thing that I've been also starting. This is something else new. I would never have a journal before for the kids. And then they ended up taking a paint chip home, and I wanted them to link it to their environment at home. So they were to take their little paint chip and go home and match something from their environment. And then the next day we came back, or I'm sorry, the next week, next time I saw them, we came back into class and we did color mixing. And again, this is like the big part of this project that I was excited for them. So I had them basically create a grid in their journals and say, find your color. So they, for a whole 45 minute period, and this was, this is where you learn to relax a little bit in art and just let the kids. But it was awesome for the kids. They had so much fun. They learned so much. They got to try different colors that they maybe didn't want to mix before because they thought it would make brown or whatever. And then I had them all record it in their journals so that next week they could come back and paint the color of their paint chip. And then we talked about how to apply their color. I had them give them funny names, like for example, a girl brought home a pink one and she found it that it matched her flowers from her mom's wedding, so she named it Rosy Pink Pie. So again, just bringing those connections from at home back into the art room. And then we just talked about, I kind of made a scenario that Crayola had hired them to make new crayons. And so we specifically looked at crayons and you know, how they have Spanish underneath the English word. So then we brought in a little bit of Spanish into the art room, which was nice. And then the last step of our how we express ourselves was a reflection on what they found about themselves with color, what color choices will they make in the future. And most of the reflections were great, and I was really excited. So, but yeah, that's basically how I changed like a two-week project into almost 4 to 6 weeks. But I think it was so much more valuable for the students to go through that journey of finding their color, and they definitely have way more ownership than as if they would have just picked a color from an egg carton. Yeah, and then the other thing that Sarah and I are kind of shared together real quickly is we always try to find connections within the classroom, and we just wanted to share real quick the sharing the planet with the third grade. They had a yep, go ahead.
You want me to? Yeah. Sure. So I since I started the PYP process, I have found natural connections of what's going on in the classroom and what I can do as a music teacher to reinforce that or give more meaning to their learning that they're already doing. So in third grade last year, I noticed that they do a big unit on sharing the planet, and they go to the recycling center and they learn, you know, how to make our environment better. And I approached the third grade teachers then and said, hey, next year, why don't we do a little program? We can add some songs to it. And they loved the idea. And so we started, and it became like a chain effect. I came up with a couple songs. Then one third grade teacher said, hey, I found a Reader's Theater one on recycling. Can we add that? And I'm like, sure. So now we have a play. And then we added the songs where they logically fit. Then another third grade teacher came up with the idea of the t-shirts. Let's just have the parents get green t-shirts. And then one parent volunteered to iron on all those little symbols on the green shirts. And then another one came up, you don't see it in the picture, but there were like signs that we held up at different times when we were singing the songs and stuff. So, and then for art, did you already do that recycling project? Jenna came up with the idea of let's make little minions out of recycled materials. So these little cute guys were on display as the parents came in for the program. So that's how we all kind of came together for this one unit of sharing the planet. So the next one, I'm going to go to fourth grade for music. What I have found teaching now my first unit planner, or at least, you know, the beginnings of teaching my first unit planner, I have found a drastic difference in how I'm approaching my teaching. Before, when I would teach recorder, fourth grade, I teach recorder, and I would just tell them, okay, this is how you play this note. Here's the music. I would teach them by rote, you know, one note at a time, teaching it to them. And that worked. The kids liked it. But this year, I tried something new. I taught them the basics, but then I started to give the ownership to the student. And after we learned Hot Cross Buns and a few easy songs, I then handed them out Ode to Joy, just the music. And I said, okay. Here's some pencils, here's some clipboards, find a friend, and they figured it out. They wrote in the notes, then they got their recorders out, and they taught the song to themselves. Or if they didn't know, they naturally found a friend who could help them. And it was amazing. I was totally terrified to do this because I was worried it would be chaos. But I walked around and all the students were like in these little pods helping each other, teaching their friend how to play the song. And then when I got us all back together and we tried playing it, it was there. It was amazing. So that's the aha moment I have had with this new unit of giving the student the ability to figure it out, inquire, try and help out each other to learn. So. And then the last piece here, we're trying something really new for the exhibition that we'll be doing in fifth grade. I'm gonna attempt to let the fifth graders write a song to perform for exhibition. So this is kind of getting all of them to work together. In each class, we've been brainstorming. I'm just at the beginning of this, so I'm excited to see what we'll have on June 12th for our fifth grade performance.
Hi, I'm Kim McMahon. I teach Spanish at Adams and a little bit at Siebert. And I have to say, I was really excited about just starting IB, PYP. Knew a little bit about it and took some classes at Oakland and got a certificate in it and was really excited to do it. And I cannot lie, I was really excited because it really validated what I do. I've been teaching Spanish in elementary for 20 years, and for the first 10, I remember always being afraid it would be the program that got cut because financially, sometimes it's hard to keep programs, and I value language. And so it was really exciting to start PYP knowing that one of the things that they require is that you have a second language. And a lot of times, right? Job security, but it's also validation that what I'm doing is important. And, you know, for years people have said, I can't believe you teach elementary Spanish. Like, we don't have that. And I've always been really proud, and we just keep making it more fundamental and more important. That's what PYP has done. As I started doing PYP, well, the great thing about it is there's a lot of global connections and language connections, and so right away, that's what I do anyway. But the whole inquiry piece has really been a little challenging and fun, and it has changed the way I teach. Also, it's harder a little bit when you're in another language, and so as I'm in Spanish, trying to teach big concepts and have them do inquiry with very limited vocabulary, sometimes it's difficult, but it's been really fun and refreshing as a teacher to try to find ways to do that where they can use their language and they can figure it out. So a lot of the stuff that I've been talking about with the kids is migration and like who we are, like who are we here in the United States because of migration. And they do that in their classrooms as well, so especially the fifth graders, that's a fifth grade unit. Whoops, I'm going backwards, sorry. I'm going to go back to that. So this is a PYP unit that I wrote with Marianne Leposky. She's a fifth grade teacher at Adams, and we did the Oakland classes together. And so we really worked hard to try to figure out how could we, what is something that she teaches that I teach that meshes? And it was explorers and, you know, immigration and things like that and migration, and it really fit with what I was doing. So I had to rethink how I did it because I was like they did before. It was, okay, here's the explorers and here, you know, and there wasn't, you know, it was just me teaching them things. And, you know, some kids got excited about it and some kids didn't. But when they're trying to figure out a question, they're a lot more interested. And so the question is in Spanish, you know, ¿por qué se habla español? And they can read it, you know, why do they speak Spanish in Mexico, the Caribbean, Central America, and South America? And so they have to figure it out. And sometimes they know and they remember from their classroom, and sometimes they don't. And so we start talking about the explorers. And this is a picture. I used to just present them. Now I'm trying to teach them to communicate. So I give a child a face. They have some like answers on the back, and the kids have to interview them and ask them the things that they know. What is your name? You know, where are you? Where did you come from? Where are you from? And they. That child will answer as the explorer, and that's how they fill it in. And then they're using their Spanish and figuring it out. And as they do that, they figure out, oh, all those explorers are from Spain, and oh, that's why they speak Spanish. And it's been really fun to, and then, well, why don't they speak Spanish in Brazil? And it really gets them thinking. And then they remember, you know, why. They remember why. And so I'll go back to this. So as we keep going through that, we start to talk about who are we in the United States. And, you know, we have a large Spanish-speaking population. Why do we learn Spanish? It's been fun for the kids to think about that. I mean, they know they'd learn it, but why is that the language that we're learning? And they start to figure out, well, it's because we have so many people here that speak Spanish. And then we have the loons, which is awesome. I'm so excited when we got Great Lakes loons because I love baseball, but also because we always have Spanish-speaking players on the team. And it's perfect. I've gotten them to come to our school, and if they don't come to the school, I just take Culture Club to meet them, but usually we can get them into the school, and the kids use their Spanish to talk to them, to ask them these questions that they have to learn by their exit. You know, when they leave, they have to be able to have a conversation, and they're excited to ask them. It's not like contrived two kids asking. It's they want to know all about these guys because they're pretty famous in their eyes, and it gives them a real reason to use their Spanish, and an exciting one, and then they get stuff signed, which is even better. But it just, it's an authentic thing that they get to do. And the other thing that I've done a lot of this throughout my teaching, but the other one I wanted to highlight was Journey North, which is something that I connect with third grade, and it is under the same theme of migration. Stephanie May is a teacher at our school who started our garden, and she found this website and said to me, have you heard of Journey North and have you done it? And I looked it up, and it's this awesome website that connects the migration of monarch butterflies from here to Mexico, something I didn't even know. They only go to like 3 overwintering forests in Mexico. That's the only place they go. They know how to go there, and there's protection there for the people, study them and protect them. And so it was another reason for the kids to think about, wow, we have these monarch butterflies here, they go there, and it connects you to these places in Mexico. There's videos and things that they can watch in the language, but they also create butterflies, and we talk about what's an ambassador in Spanish, and we talk about who are we here, and they have to create a butterfly from their class that explains who are we in Midland, Michigan, United States of America. And then they make their own butterflies and put their little faces on it. They stand like this, and their hands are, you know, antennas. And they write little notes, and they go to Mexico. And then we get to find out where they went in Mexico. We get to see the pictures of the kids holding their butterflies. We get to ask questions to the kids in the schools there because it's all connected, you know, via the internet. And then this spring, they will get butterflies back, like at the same time that the monarchs come back. And then they get to read letters from these kids in a Spanish-speaking country where it's a very different way of life. It's a very poor area. And it's just really another really authentic thing they do, and it totally connects with their science unit in third grade where they raise butterflies. And so we also do a hungry caterpillar unit, and we learn about foods. But it just, it all really connects. And so it's been so fun to see how much the kids get more excited and grow in their learning when they want to know the answers and they're inquiring and they're figuring things out and doing things that are really meaningful. So I, for one, for five or whatever, am really excited that we get to do this. So thank you.
I think what you felt off of that is just the energy. I mean, the enthusiasm from everyone and how they are bringing that into their classrooms, and really that's the exciting thing that we're seeing with our students and with the staff. It is energizing in the way that it's pushing all of us to do things differently in our conversations at the building levels. It is building a common process for students for inquiry. The language is the same, so it's not so itemy. It's not, this is music time, and then we're going to PE, and now we're going to go do math. It's bringing people together, and I think that is my favorite part. It was an exciting journey, really, to go through the authorization process, but this year, to me, it's kind of like the blossoming of the whole piece, where it's pulling in the auxiliaries and pulling everybody together in that connectedness. Seeing much more collaboration was highlighted in everyone's pieces tonight, whether it's across auxiliaries with music and art, or it's connecting with the PE end of the year piece globally, or it's connecting with fifth grade on the Journey North pieces. You see it every day, and you feel it in the building. Professional development meetings, we had one today. It's just a different kind of energy in there when everyone feels like they're working together, and it's that enthusiasm. So we hope that we share that with you today. Do you have any questions about any of the things that are going on?
Yeah, I have a few. First of all, let me just say it's really awesome to see this paradigm shift that you've all experienced going through this process as it relates to education. And seeing the energy and the excitement just in you guys here tonight, I can only imagine how excited these kids are to come to class and to do these cool experiences like the international butterflies or speaking to the loons players in their native language. Wendy, one thing I wanted to ask you is when they're up there hanging, let me ask you a different one. What are they writing for their reflections? Okay. There were some pictures there, but I couldn't really read what they were.
Used to a microphone.
Actually,
it's interesting this year because, again, this has been a 3.5-year evolution. The reflections would be what have you learned in volleyball that you could apply to other sports, or what is something that you've learned that you've learned from another sport that you applied here? So we're trying to make those connections. And now this year, because we're doing learning targets, the learning targets I put on the board are questions, and then those learning targets come back in the form of reflection. And that's a new part of my evolution, is incorporate, you know, I try to be as efficient as I can with my 1 hour, you know, that I see them. And so being able to do a learning target in the form of a question and then bringing that back in reflection, that gives that everything that we've been doing for, 4 weeks, 3 weeks, it gives it even more meaning for them, so.
And this is, I guess, I'll limit my questions. to anybody who wants to answer this, are you noticing any animosity with the new ownership? That is, the kids now have to write a song. The kids have to take ownership with their art and create their color instead of having it, I guess, traditionally spoon-fed to them. Is anybody, how are they reacting to the new style?
I'm sorry. This is one of the things that I noticed right away was that because we do the team concept, we do that naturally in gym. And so now they're doing these kinds of group where they have to work together in groups in a team and have goals, and it's easier in gym now. It's just we come in, we sit in a team meeting, we have these discussions, and there's no fighting, there's no, oh, this is wasting our playing time. They've bought right in. It's just, it's seamless almost, especially after 3.5 years.
Of course, it's just been one class so far, but every single fifth grader was engaged in my classroom. All of them had ideas of what song we could use. Again, we're in the brainstorm process, but all of them are taking ownership so far in the writing the song. And the recorders, the same thing. They're all learning. They all are enjoying playing. So
that's
I haven't
great.
Noticed any animosity.
I have a different answer. I agree. I think a lot of kids are really excited, and this is maybe a negative but a positive in the end. I have noticed some kids, and I probably would have been one of those students, who are teacher pleasers, and they want to do the right thing and have the right answer, and then here you go, and give me the package, and I'll give you my product, and this is what you want, and what do you want, and what are the rules? And for those kids, it's a little struggle. I think I see some frustration, like, what do you mean? I don't know. Tell me what I'm supposed to know. But that's okay. It's uncomfortable for them. I understand. I would have been uncomfortable too. But it is so good for them, because the longer that we do it, the more that I see them get comfortable and be more willing to be risk takers, which is one of their learner profile attributes, that some kids just aren't naturally risk takers. And they might be really good students, but they're afraid to, you know, they're afraid to trust their intelligence. And so this has been good for those kids to get a little out of their teacher pleaser box and really take some risks that I think will benefit them, you know, as adults in the future.
Would just add, the level of engagement is significantly up amongst the students because, like the picking the color thing, you're a participant versus being engaged. When you have to choose your own color, you know, the warm hues, cool colors, etc., all the things that were covered, you've got to be able to apply that knowledge. And you are engaged, and therefore, you know, you're far more invested in the connections that the kids are making as well. As Wendy mentioned in her gym, the reflections after the sports that are played, they're reflecting about how the team worked, how did we handle adversity, how did we handle when someone made a mistake. All those, there's the depth of learning is significantly up. I would say that's equal with the level of engagement. So it, in my opinion, in doing the classroom observations, not having the responsibility of conducting the class, having the luxury of watching what's going on, you've got higher engagement and you've got greater depth of learning. And it's really, really been powerful, and they've done a very nice job.
They have indeed.
I just have a couple comments. I was jotting down words that you all kind of touched on. You know, connections, exciting, which is huge, I think, with student learning. If they're excited, they want to learn. And authentic, life, things that they apply to life, and how much fun they're having doing this and making these connections all between the different classes, and whether it's science and math or art and music. I just applaud you, and it makes me think, no, I would have liked to have gone to school and done this. Thank you.
So, yeah, thank you. I know last year I had the opportunity. I was talking to actually another Adams teacher, and I just know that it's a lot of work that you all have put into mm-hmm. creating these units. And thank you so much for all the effort that you've put in. This is wonderful.
Very impressive. Very impressive. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I know. Very cool. All right, moving into item 4, which is 4.1, bond construction bids. me to take that, or?
Sure, you could, if you want it. You'll go through it, or you want me to?
All right, so 4.1 is bond construction bids. So administration recommends approval of the following, which are part of the bond projects utilizing Series 1 bonds. All of these recommendations are awarded to the low bidders. So 4.11, do we do these individually?
I usually just say the name and the amount.
Pardon me?
I usually say the contractor and the dollar amount.
Oh, I know, but do we have to vote on them separately?
No, you can vote
them all together. Okay, so 4.11, the bid package for district-wide secure entry and video surveillance award recommendations. So general change will be Pumford Construction, $289,000, aluminum entrances, architectural glazing systems, $295,951. Mechanical, William E. Walters Incorporated, $60,420. Electrical, Master Electric, $90,400. Video surveillance and access control, Security Corporation, for $532,409. So the total award amount for this bid package is $1,268,180. Bid package 4.1.2 is the STEM Playground Award recommendation. This is to Playground Equipment Sinclair Recreation for $73,900. So the total amount of the bid package would be the $73,900. So at this time, I take motion.
I move to approve items 4.1.1 and 4.1.2.
Support.
Okay, moved by Pam, supported by Scott. Is there any discussion?
I just have to make a minor clarification. Okay. Says that all of these recommendations are awarded to the low bidders, which that is true for all of them, but video surveillance and access controls is a cumulative low of combining them, because there is a relational between those two products. Mm-hmm. So we are doing a cumulative award to combine those two bids.
All right, thank you.
I just wanted to say that the presentation on those STEM-related equipment going to be at the new school are just extraordinary learning opportunities for kids beyond the classroom. It's going to be awesome.
Had a chance to see some of the items that are going into these playgrounds, and there will have to be a parent play day. Because I know I will have a lot of fun. Yes, they're fabulous. Any other questions or comments? All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? All right. Moving into 4.2. Administration recommends board approval of the 2017-18 school calendar, recently ratified as a letter of agreement by the Midland City Education Association. So to highlight, the calendar features a starting date for classes of September 5th this year, and the final day of school will be June 14th, 2018, which will meet the required 180 days of instruction. So at this time, entertain a motion.
I move to approve item 4.2.
Support.
Okay, moved by Pam, supported by Mary. Is there any discussion or questions on this?
Spring break will be Friday, March 30th through April 6th. I know there will be a lot of people wanting that information as soon as possible.
Be on our website tomorrow morning. We put that out and communicate pending your approval.
All right. I'll probably wait till after spring break to start next year's planning.
That works.
All right, any other questions or comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All right, all those opposed? All right, the calendar for next year passes. Moving into 4.3, which is the 2016-17 budget adjustment. Turn it over to Bob.
Take just a minute here, getting set up. Be a shorter presentation than we think. There you go.
It's on the TV, but not the screen, guys.
All
Cindy, can that, does that screen pull out a little bit? No? Can you guys see that at all?
I can see it.
I can see it.
How about Brad, you on your
end? Can we turn that light off above it?
Yeah.
My chance?
Oh, there you go.
Oh, wow.
Well, would you start there, Bob, while Dave's playing?
Yep. Everybody set?
Mm-hmm.
All right, as you know, it's, I guess, the budget season again. It goes a long time. So this is just the start. You know that school budgets, just to remind everybody out there, are not advisory in nature, like most people think of a budget. It has to reflect, basically, both the accounting of the source of the income and how we're spending that income. So as you go through the course of a year, you have to do what are called budget adjustments, and I'll ask you to approve that after we finished with this one. It's typically to do one halfway through February, March, just depends on how much we have accumulated, what needs to be done, and you have to do another one at the very end of the year again. The confusing part about that, and go to the next one, is that the timeline, as you look at it, here we are at the mid-year budget revision on March 20th. We will do a starts at 6:30 prior to the board meeting on the 17th in April. That's usually our budget workshop. Depends how much information is out from the state, how much I can tell you at the budget workshop, because we're very dependent on, at that time, looking at student enrollment. I'll be able to share some of the major costs that we have coming that we know of, some of those personnel costs, and hopefully we'll know enough about the state budget we can share with you where we are. Sometimes in April, it's still getting filled in. The governor is always way out in front. Just depends if the House and Senate are there. And if you have both of those, you can make a pretty good guess. If you only have one and not the other two, it's hard to know how that will work out. But that's coming up on the 17th. And then we bring you the proposed 17-18 budget on the first board meeting in June. And then we follow that up with an interesting meeting always, because you're going to do your final approval of the 16-17 budgets, and at the same time, you're going to adopt the 17-18 budget for the first time. And one of the reasons that I wanted to point that date out to you also is because with those two things going on at the same time, you have to remember that we are closing out one budget before we are actually at the end of the year. And so typically, the audited numbers that come back after that should be close, but they're not going to be dead on. So sometimes in our current budget, you'll see it here in a minute when I run through it, our fund balance prediction of where we were going to even start the year is off. And if it's off, either high or low, it throws off, and we adjust it this time. So that's there. Okay, there are typically some different major factors that affect the budget adjustment as you go. In this case, it's student enrollment. It's always a little guessing game. We budgeted for 7,685. If you remember, it was more of a guessing go this time because we had the, if you will, Dow Corning situation going on, and nobody really could predict. I think we came pretty darn close. I think we more likely have seen between the two count days more effect of that because we've lost a few more students. That's typical in that gap, but it looks like a few more as we've looked at our spring count. But right now we're up seven, so again, that'll cause a budget adjustment because they're about 8,300 apiece, so you can get an idea of the kinds of things we have to change in the budget adjustment. Sometimes there's volatility and timing in the state funding. For 16-17, we had most of the information when we started, so that makes it a little different a year that way. Sometimes we've been waiting for all kinds of information to come in. We always have local revenue factors. I don't know how else to say this, but Midland's different. You know, I've been in the job now 3 years. Whenever you try to get any advice from somebody, as soon as you start describing it, they go, ooh, we don't have anything like that. We have a lot of personal property tax, for example. So when the personal property tax exemption came in, how we were going to get reimbursed by that wasn't very clear. A check appeared. That's good because that much local revenue wasn't there, so it just replaces it. But you weren't sure how that was going to go. We also have a lot of, I'll call them development zones, renaissance zones, brownfields, and they vary from year to year. The two biggies lately where they actually capture the money, we have to pay it back and the state makes it up, are the East End and the Shaheen building that's being built. Those both are capturing money back, and literally the city gives us the local tax, then turns around and bills us for it back again. And so we have to make sure the state understands that so that they make up that difference. But they will affect some of your budget numbers. They're hard to predict. We also get changes in special services, and the reason for that's pretty simple. You don't know the population that you're serving and the disabilities involved. And in certain cases, it's just more expensive than others, and others it's not. You can bus more, you can bus less. And so there'll be changes in the funding for special education, both through us, through the ESA, in both situations. And then the other big thing always, of course, is the budget variation. You know, we reach the end of the year, using the budget I put in 1%. I always hope it's a lot more than that, but you know, where's it been? Anywhere from a little bit negative to 3%. We haven't seen 3% in a long time, but budget variation just means that they don't spend everything that they had and that comes back to us. Or sometimes it could be we received a little bit more money in the end. We want that, okay? That's the good thing to happen, so it's not bad. Okay, so there are major revenue changes. Again, I just tried to highlight some for you today. The bottom line's the important part, if you will. The revenue changes that we're seeing in this March adjustment, about 1.33 or 1.34 million. Starting with the state funding increase, student enrollment's part of that. The section 22A, 22B, those are state aid categories. The 22F, we knew we were gonna get, but believe it or not, a year ago there were two 22Fs, and they said you're gonna get one of them. We actually got both of them. It's a good thing. So that's a chunk of it. And then some of the Renaissance Zone brownfield offsets, so the state is up that way. Our Medicaid reimbursement, which you can bill for Medicaid for our special needs students, and that's down from where we thought it would be. There's lots of reasons for that. Sometimes you don't have as much service as the year before, which is what you're really basing it on. And there are some things that get denied when you bill them. In other words, they don't consider that a legitimate billable thing. And in some cases, we've had one where they've decided afterwards whether our psychologist could bill or not, depending on what their degree was. Not that we knew that going in. That's an afterthought, but that happens sometimes. They come back in and say, you know, these people can bill. Guess what? These people can't bill. Nobody's fault, just different interpretations. If you've been involved in the state long enough, you know that will happen. That you'll get, they'll tell you one thing one year and you turn right around the next year and it's changed again. So that does happen. For example, and you'll see some with the letter C on here, a lot of things that come into revenue go right back out or are restricted in where they go. So we applied for an early literacy grant, $83,000 increased revenue, all going back out because the grant specified what it was supposed to be used for in early literacy. The Section 24 are students that are placed by the courts through lots of different ways. So you get some money for those. Again, that's not very predictable. It's just what's happening in that school year. Federal grants, that's sometimes carryover, sometimes just a little bit difference in the funding as to what we thought was coming in. That goes right back out. The TRIG grants are the same way. That's technology. And so we got a little bit extra there that we're spending. You always get a special ed, a state aid adjustment. In this case, it's down, sometimes it's up. They're always funding you from the year before. So when they see your final numbers and stuff that are coming in, they'll start adjusting how much they've been giving you. So it just depends on where you're at. 147C, that's the state's contribution towards the state retirement system. It puts a cap on it. Always hard to predict. Not always based, you would think, with all the young teachers we took in, that should go down. Okay, because again, it's using some of the information from a year ago, so it doesn't necessarily do that. And of course, depending on where the retirement rates are going, it can fluctuate. So we got some there. You'll see on the other side, it's going right back out again. 147C money is, right, here you go, write us a check back. So it just goes in and out as we do that. And then I wanted to put there, it really does not affect the general fund at all, but I did want you to know our STEM grants, as you know, we've got a lot of foundational money coming in, and it looks like we're gonna be ahead by $277,000 this year. So again, that's reserved. It really doesn't show them the general fund, it doesn't show them the general fund revenues, but I wanted you to know in the fund balance, you would see that. Now remember that 1.34 revenue coming in? Here's your major expense changes. I'm gonna draw your attention to the bottom. There it's 1.32. So this is a very, I hate to call it in and out budget adjustment, but it is. About as much revenue as came in is going right back out in different kinds of expenditures. We had some reductions, but we also had some additional expenses, so it just depends. We had some staff-related ones. You might say, how'd that happen? Well, remember, we were hiring a lot of people, so when we gave you the budget back in June, we had no idea where the salaries were gonna come in. So I think we came pretty close. We didn't know how much experience we would have, what we'd have to grant, so there was some money left there. Our bidding out of the property and liability insurance this year, $31,000. Remember that 147C money, it kind of affects the retirement too, because if you have less salary, then the retirement that goes to the state is less. So, you know, actually it's not a very big amount, but we'd have some FICA savings too, so reduced expenditures. There's the federal grants going back and forth. There's the 147C rate cap. We're getting more, I call them taxable value changes or paybacks, more, not the big tax appeals you used to think of, but I'd say more board of review, mid to smaller size companies, and they're just adding up. More people going to the appeal process saying, I think I'm being assessed too high. And so you're seeing a bit more of that. And those are all then taxes we collected based on what they thought their taxable value was that we have to pay back. So it's a little higher than it's been. Our special ed education billing from the SA is down a little bit, so they didn't bill us for as much. And then finally, the bottom one, as you remember, as part of our settlement with the teachers early, was that we funded their HSA earlier. And so you'll see that that was $322,000 more. Now, the nice thing about that is, if you saw the revenue coming in and the expenses going out, we were able to do that funding of the HSA and really not change where the budget stands. So that's a very good thing as we go forward for everybody. Wanted to give you the big snapshot that you usually like to see. Where are we with the general funds as you look at it? You can see where the revenue was about $78.7 million, now going to be, as our March adjustment, about just a little bit over $80 million. So it's up that 1.34. If you look at the budgeted expenditures, was about 77.7. It's now about 79. So again, you see the increase there. The surplus that we thought we'd have, and remember that's the first time we've had a surplus in a long time, we thought that our revenues would exceed our expenditures by about a million, just a little bit more. And you'll see it's still in almost the exact same ballpark. What is that, 17,000 difference. So a little bit of difference, but not a lot. Remember that budget variance? Again, just to give you an idea, we're thinking 1% of expenses. So you can see that we were still anticipating a surplus at the end of about 1.8 or 1.9 million when we get there. If we get more budget variance, that would be higher. If you get less budget variance, then it's not going to be that much. So again, we'll know a lot more in June, and even better when you get the audit back on that. The fund balance looks like, boy, how did that jump that high? Remember what I said, when we started this budget and adopted it in June, we didn't have the audited fund balance. So if you look at the difference between those two numbers there, how did it jump by, it's about 1.1 or 1.2 million. It's exactly the difference in the starting spot. So when you adopted the budget in June, we had projected that we were going to end last year at about 8.6 million. We actually ended up, if you remember, way better than that, and we ended up more at like 9.7. So the difference is really in our starting point. So all we're doing with this budget adjustment is saying, look, our first starting point was not good. If we put the same amount of money away, we're going to have more money. So that's where we're at. So again, the percentage you can see there is the 14.7 instead of the 13.4 we had. We'll fine-tune it more as we go. So when you get to that June budget, you get to the end, you know what people are going to spend or not spend or did spend, and that will change slightly. But I think I can tell you that, you know, looking better than lots of messages I've had to bring to you for for a while. And you know, we keep doing that. I think it's allowed us to do some of the things that we want to do. If you were to look ahead, these are the kinds of things we'll talk about both in April and then in the June budgets when they come forward. And this is more towards the 17-18 budget than it is 16-17, but we have our balance, our budget process. If you're new to us, that's where each building, each program comes in and sits down with myself and the business financial director, and it's Mike stops in, but they talk to us about their needs. And we've been trying to hold that side of the budget, which is not very big. Don't forget, most of our costs is in personnel because we're a personnel-driven business. But the 15% that goes elsewhere, we try to hold the lid on, but we're also looking at ways to maybe put some money there, I would tell you that we're slightly more optimistic, not across the board, but that we can maybe put some money, Mike, you call them silos, so I'll call it the same thing, but where maybe we could set aside some for furniture, let's say. Now, it might not go to every building, but we could start maybe a little silo where we could say, hey, if somebody needs some furniture, you know, this year goes here and here. Or the same could be said for activities to close the achievement gap kind of thing. So if we can get to the right point, we can build some of those to help us do some of the things that we'd like to do. The student enrollment's always going to be a biggie. Hard to predict. Consultant hasn't reported yet, so I couldn't tell you exactly where we'll be there. I'll have some kind of prediction for you in April, but I'll have to fine-tune that by June. We'll know that. The state funding, I think Mike's mentioned in his Friday letter a few times, it's, there are some very good points in the governor's proposal. Whether that's what we get to or not is a different matter. The 31A alone would be a big chunk of it. This governor's about $1.7 million. It's got use for the at-risk students. That's what we use it for. So there's a lot of good places we can use that in the process. But again, you also hear things like that Title IIA, which is money we use, might be totally gone. And if that's gone, then that's something right now funds learning coaches, different professional development that we'd have to be looking to fill. Let's see, personnel costs. We'll have a little better idea. Staffing levels will be just in April, kind of in the middle of it all. So we won't really know, with the number of students we have, how much personnel do we need, and what grade, and all those kinds of things. But we will have a better idea of salaries and the benefits, hopefully, that we can talk to you about, because we should have our medical rates by then. So at least we'll know going forward what kind of percentage increase we'd look for there. And I say percentage increase because we guarantee you it's a percentage increase. It's not going down. So that will happen. We get a better idea later on about our transfers too with the ESA, because don't forget they run some of the special needs programs. We run some. It's actually an exchange of the checks when it works, and sometimes we come out a little ahead and they come out a little ahead, so it's something that we have to take a look at. And again, the available fund balance. Touch it, don't touch it, use a little bit of it. I mean, those are all questions that boards answer, so those are there. Like always, got questions, I'll be glad to answer them now. We try to make sure that the presentation and a copy of the budget, the budget's always on, even the amended ones, is always on the transparency website. We try to put a clip of this part of the presentation at least on the website too, so you can see that. And then again, the next time you would basically look at this is in June, and we'd have you amend that last time with the budget. The board does need to approve the amendment.
To approve the 2016-17 budget adjustment?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, moved by Scott, supported by Pam. Are there any questions, discussion?
I think it's good news, and it looks like the budget process is working well, and it's been a real team effort and a lot of work and concessions and going after the same outcomes together as a team, and I guess that's what really makes this work and is exciting. I'm actually thrilled that the teachers and were able to get the HSA amount in their accounts. I think that's a great win for them as well.
At this time, all those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? All right, the budget adjustment passes. Next up, do you want to?
Well, I can take it.
You want me? I can do it.
Yeah, you just approved the budget. I'll just now spend some of it for you, right? No.
Well, I think this is money well spent.
Yes, it is. 4.4, we're recommending the purchase of a 2017 GMAC one-ton pickup truck to replace a 1984 Dodge box truck with 90,000 local miles on it. This 2017 pickup will be purchased from the state bid site, so you don't see the bid tabs like you do. You go there and they bring up the different products. I know it was chosen, we need a pretty heavy duty bed in these things. Not that they get abused, but things get put in there. And so we were a little concerned about the aluminum ones to start with, so I know that's one of the reasons that this was here. It's replacing a box truck. It's really, I also wanted to mention to you, I'll have another vehicle. We haven't bought a vehicle since 2011. We bought a one-ton dump truck. We bought a couple off the city used. They're actually looking better if you see one around. Got a new bed in the back that we've been working on, but I don't know when the last time we bought a pickup truck is. It's been a while. So Grounds, of course, uses them quite a bit. Wimerke also buy a, I'll call it a cargo van, but you've seen the bigger backed ones. We have a lot of old box trucks that we're running our maintenance skilled trades guys out of. Costly, pretty old, expensive to run, so we're hoping to get one more yet this year. So those are coming.
At this time, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
All right, moved by Mary. Do I have support?
Support.
Support by Scott. Is there any discussion?
What's going to happen to the 1984 Dodge box truck?
We sell every even buses when they're replaced. We sell them. There's always a market someplace. We sold the record 3 or 4 years ago. I don't know how old the record was.
40 years.
Yeah, at least 40 years old. Then we get a, I think, a pretty good return on them.
So it goes to a bid, or?
We can go through agents. Usually we go through an auction agency, but or we can bid about ourselves.
Buses usually end up.
All right, well, two comments I have. One, this was purchased when I was a freshman in high school, which is a long time ago. And secondly, this pickup truck does have several products on it that Next Tier makes.
Oh, all right.
So it has some local content on it, made in Saginaw, Michigan. So anyway, that's a good thing, too. Any other comments? Questions? All right. This time, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? All right, we have our new pickup truck.
I can take the next one if you want, though I'm not a TV expert, but I can do it.
That would be great.
Okay, we have actually a City of Midland grant to help keep our TV station running. They've done this a couple times for us, a kind of a 5-year grant, and this one would upgrade our system, hardware, software, relocation of equipment, all bringing it to the HD and HD or HD-SDI for routing through the system, which should improve the quality that we get all the time because our equipment's just getting outdated again. So we're recommending the purchase order to the low and only bidder, Advanced Lighting and Sound out of Troy, Michigan, $19,877. And there's also some selected items that need to be there for $1,824. And that's all going to be purchased with that grant from the City of Midland. It's kind of a unique area to bid in. It's kind of a select people that would be in that area with these kind of devices. So.
All right, at this time I'll entertain a motion.
I'll move for the approval of item 4.5.
Support.
Is that one?
Yes.
Moved by Scott, supported by Ian. Are there any questions or comments?
Big thank you to the City of Midland. I think it's so important to have the TV station to bring board meetings like this to the community. So a big thank you.
Improving quality is always a good thing too. You know, you want to look your best.
All right, all those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed? All right, thank you to the City of Midland. At this time, we'll move into item 5, which is request to address the board. Did we have any? All right, is there anybody who would like to address the board? All right, seeing none, we will move into item 6, which is curriculum, instruction, and assessment. So let's see, we had a meeting in February.
We do, and I have some meeting minutes. Okay, the meeting was Monday, February 20th, and the curriculum team went to the MSU STEM Center for a tour, and the committee was provided the tour by MSU STEM Center, of the STEM Center, by Dr. Daniel Henton, and included a review of lab spaces, 3D printing training center, equipment, resources, materials, collaborative events that have occurred between Midland Public Schools and MSU so far. It was a great tour. I was just so impressed by the facility and the number of collaborative events that were being held there, and just the higher level of opportunities for improving education and professional development. I just thought it was great. Then today we had a STEM strategic plan. Oh no, this was that same day. We had the STEM strategic plan progress update. Brian Brutin presented an overview of the of Midland Public Schools actions and activities correlated to the outcomes articulated in the STEM strategic plan. Activities and actions included Project Lead the Way curriculum integration. The Project Lead the Way launch training occurred in August and was led by four master teachers. 47 total Midland Public School participants were trained representing seven schools. Teacher leaders, administration, community volunteers, and university partners were present. The session held in MPS was the largest Project Lead the Way launch training ever facilitated in Michigan. Launch training is ongoing and curriculum pilots are underway in numerous MPS elementary schools. Central Park will be the first Midland Public School elementary to integrate Project Lead the Way launch curriculum next year, and all elementary schools will begin implementation in the fall of 2018. Project Lead the Way training for secondary teachers is scheduled to commence during the 17-18 school year. Four subcommittees are currently studying applicable secondary course integration pathways, and the subcommittee work will result in an applicable major change proposal that we'll see in the fall of 2017. Collaborating with university partners, collaborating with Michigan State University, Saginaw Valley State University, Central Michigan University, and Michigan Technology University has been ongoing. Partnerships have evolved to include the utilization of facilities, student internships, training, robotics facility enhancements, and curriculum implementation, including Carbon Time and MyStar. Technology infusion. Laptops were deployed to all 6th through 8th grade students during the 15-16 school year. Chromebooks were deployed to 9th through 12th grades students at the start of the 16-17 year, and plans for K through 5 devices will be infused in the 17-18 year, and that's in progress. Increasing access to out-of-school time STEM learning opportunities. Agreements have been forged with entities such as Engineering for Kids, the Community Center, The Rock, and Bedtime Math to provide enhanced access to quality STEM learning opportunities for all students beyond the school day. In addition, efforts to support the growth of robotics program at all levels have been implemented. After this nice long meeting, we were adjourned at 3:45, but it was very engaging and interesting and exciting for our district.
Thank you. All right, moving into staff development proposals. Ryan.
Tonight we bring forward 15 staff development proposals that will begin this summer if they do get approved at the next meeting. A quick review of the process before I get into some of the details. These staff development proposals are originated either through the curriculum office administrators or also through building principals and teachers as well too, including our teacher leaders. Those staff development proposals get vetted by an internal committee that is made up of teachers and administrators from the building and from the district level. And after they're vetted by our internal committee, they also go to the board CIA committee as well, of the meeting of which we just had today, and discuss those for close to 2 hours. So tonight, again, 15 proposals are coming to you for information only. These will be before the public and for the board for the next 28 days, and we will ask the board to take action at the next meeting. The theme of this year's staff development proposals really revolves around the goal of helping to reduce the achievement gap, and we're excited that there's a lot of building level initiatives here that really are grassroots. Two of focus is one at Dow High, where the ELA department is looking to increase the rigor of their ninth grade English offerings, and the Midland High Math Initiative, where they've been working on increasing the rigor levels of their math offerings for all students, will continue as well. These were originated from the buildings, and we are proud to support them in their effort to help close the achievement gap. Two other proposals of note that are significant will be a pretty substantial investment into retraining our co-teaching pairs. We know that co-teaching helped us realize many, many gains. It's been a while since we have recalibrated ourselves in our co-teaching ventures, so we're looking to do that. And with the onset of one-to-one devices in the elementary, we need to devote some significant time to Google training for all of our elementary teachers as well. So again, all of the paperwork and information behind these proposals is available in the curriculum office. We're happy to review those with anyone that would like to, and we'll bring these back to you again at the next board meeting for action.
All right, thank you very much. Moving on to FFO.
Yes, I have.
Read the minutes from our meeting last Monday.
I have minutes from March 13th, 2017. Discussed a variety of things at the meeting. The first was the Miracle League baseball field. Mr. Kurt Yockey was there to present the committee with an overview of the Michigan Miracle Baseball League sponsored by the Easter Seals and its search for an appropriate field location in the Midland area. Perhaps some properties that we have may be considered, and we discussed those, just discussion levels only at this point. Had a bond work update. Mr. Dumbrell of Barton Mallow and Ms. Carlson of Friends Associates provided an overview of the outdoor learning environments at Central Park Elementary and their various components, such as cisterns, ground maps, planets, and garden areas that will be purchased and installed. Bids for the secure entries, including video surveillance and access control, were reviewed. Providers of the video surveillance and access control will be making a final presentation this week to demonstrate their systems and their interconnectivity before a final selection is made based on software and equipment. Playground equipment bids were just received and are undergoing the review process before the final selection will be presented for approval. Central Park classroom furniture selection was also shown. The need for additional classrooms at Woodcrest Elementary was also discussed. Then financials were reviewed, which Bob just went through at length. I'll spare you most of that, but Mr. Cooper and the committee reviewed the January financial reports, additional topics discussed by the committee of the upcoming March budget adjustment, Chartwell's food service contract renewal, purchase of a new pickup truck, contracts of postal talks, and renewal of the building cleaning contract with EnviroClean. Next meeting scheduled for Monday, April 10th.
All right, thank you very much. Bob.
Okay, I have gifts for you tonight. First, for information, we have seven gifts totaling $6,331.50. You see there's a lot from our PTOs on this list. Also, the JPAC at Jefferson, the Dow High Boosters Club, the Murphy family for Plymouth field trips, and the Kiwanis for incentives at Eastlawn. I do have, though, two items for action. They're listed kind of different there, but 7.3 and 7.4. The first action, because of the both items, actually, for their value being over 5,000, it's the board policy to accept those gifts. There's 5,000 for middle and high robotic entry fees, materials. That's from the first of Great Lakes Bay region. And then second, we have a gift of a 2017 Ford 12-passenger van. It's being donated to Middle Public Schools by the Gandy family. And it's got priority, their gift was with the priority use being given to transportation of middle high athletic teams. The board would need to approve both of those.
Motion to approve items 7.3 and 7.4.
I move to approve items 7.3 and 7.4.
Support.
Moved by Pam, support by Patrick. Are there any questions or comments?
That's a quick question. I wasn't sure. Under the other donations from the Dow High Boosters, what's HUDL?
I wish I could tell you. It's a video.
Brian again.
You, Brian, you know the.
Huddle is a video upload software. It's actually a website. So it back in the day, coaches used to have to travel to exchange videos, and now you can upload those videos into a website called Huddle, and coaches can then exchange passwords and videos that way. So it's a athletic software.
Right. Share clips with their players as well.
Right.
Sponsored by MHS.
My daughter's very excited about it.
I guess I have a comment too. Mr. and Mrs. Gandy giving a 12-passenger van to the schools is quite an amazing gift, and a huge thank you for that, as well as for the first Great Lakes Bay region. Our robotics is one of the best around, and without that kind of support, it would be hard to compete.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? All right, thank you very much for the generosity of many people in our community. All right, moving into human resources. Let's see, first of all, I guess Scott.
I have some very short minutes to read.
Okay.
We met on Thursday, March 1st at 12 p.m. Present, along with myself, was Lynn Baker, Pat Frazee, Mr. Sherrill, and Cynthia Marchese. We discussed an appeal wherein Ms. Marchese provided background information with regard to an appeal that's going to be presented to this committee later in March.
All right. Thank you very much. Moving into 8.2, do you want to
take
this one?
Board and staff extend their sympathy to the family of Mr. James Nelson, who passed away on February 19th. Mr. Nelson taught fifth grade in sixth grade at Plymouth Elementary School. Mr. Nelson was an MPS staff member for 28 years, retiring in 1989.
Thoughts for their family. All right, moving into 8.3, the following staff members have announced their retirements. Long list. All right, moving into 9. Correspondence to and from the Board of Education. Listed here in 9.1 are letters from the Board of Education. 9.2 are a couple of FOIA requests that we have received. Moving into item 10, this is just the listing of our next meetings. And just as was already brought out this tonight, our next meeting on April 17th will begin at 6:30 instead of 7 with the board workshop. And the regular meeting will begin immediately after the board workshop ends. And at this time, we will move into item 11, which is our study discussion session. And Mary, I'll start with you.
I get to be first. I just wanted to say again how excited I am about the STEM playground equipment that's going to be going into place. And I hope that there's some way through some benefactors or something that we can get some of that same kind of playground equipment at all our elementary buildings, because mm-hmm. it's going to be such an awesome learning experience for the kids. And like Angela said, we gotta have adult playtime too, because it's pretty cool stuff. I also wanted to put a kind of a heads up smiley face kind of thing. The CTE Health Care Tech Partnership, the update has a picture here of a student that's involved in that from Dow High. But actually, I was at the hospital visiting a friend, and there was a healthcare tech student that's doing co-oping from Midland High there. And I just was so proud to have a student that was so professional and knowledgeable about what was going on and what his role was and how excited he was about opportunities that are available for him when he graduates. So that was pretty cool too. Goosebumps with the presentation tonight. I wish I could be a student in their classroom again, because it does sound like so many exciting things, and I could see how kids would be really involved. And one of the things I jotted down was parent involvement as well, getting parents on board and helping with those projects. So that's what I have.
Good. I would echo that with that PYP presentation. Oh my goodness, you know, we're excited. They keep talking about the kids and the excitement, but boy, you can just feel the staff excitement as they've been learning it right along with the students and coming up with great ways to learn. So, and I just know that we're going to see great great things coming up in the future. Congratulations again to Judy and Lori. I always enjoy the shining stars, people that are kind of behind the scenes and don't always get the recognition that maybe they deserve. Was it the Rock fundraiser the other night? I just wanted to comment. It was fantastic, but I was very proud to be the MPS partners with them, and the statistics. Mike was there as well, and Pam and several of us. It's amazing how many students they touch and the life skills, and so it's nice that we're a part of that, and they very much appreciate us being the partner with them. And I believe, did I read right, there's a robotics competition this weekend at Dow High. So I'm looking forward to stopping in. I don't really think along those lines, but to go and watch is just amazing. It's very exciting, and I'm so impressed what our students can do from just the programming, the business plan, the everything that they do. So if you get a chance, you'll want to stop over there. And I believe spring break will happen before we meet again. So I know everyone looks forward to that.
Thank you. Brad? I just wanted to remind everybody that this Friday is the Booster Bash. Yeah. And that will be located at the Great Hall. And that is our primary annual fundraiser. So would invite everyone to attend that is around and bring your friends. It's a lot of fun to be had and things to bid on and a lot of prizes. So it's a very fun event. Also want to make a comment about the IB primary years program. Contracts that involve safety, goals, reflections on goals by having team meetings, execution of tasks to achieve goals, team review, well, all tying that to personal ownership and accountability, and building mutual trust and confidence of the students and the teachers was really amazing. And all those core items and talking about team meetings, those children are going to have an understanding, a little bit more understanding, of what their moms and dads do in their career world every day, understanding what a real meeting means. And also that they're going to understand in their education that answers must be derived by collaboration. You're not given the answers in the work world. You have to figure them out, and you have to work with other people to figure those out. And it's very exciting that they're going to learn that at an incredibly young age.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. I thought tonight was a great meeting. I guess I kind of spoke a little bit at length about the presentation tonight, which was very impressive. I just wanted to highlight, I guess in closing, I was really impressed to see item 6.2, the number of initiatives that are being developed to really close the achievement gap. We don't highlight that often during these meetings, and it's just important to draw attention to. Again, I think it's great, and I really look forward to approving these and moving forward with them in 28 days, especially the elementary Google training, charging forward with the technological education is just mandatory. It seems like a high price tag, but you can have these iPads and these devices, and if you don't know what you're doing with them, they're useless. So it's important to know that, and the co-teacher training, I think, is extremely useful as well. So all good stuff and money I think we're happy to spend and move the ball forward.
I agree. I think this was one of my favorite meetings. A lot of great things are happening, and to piggyback off what you had talked about closing the gap is just that growth mindset, really looking at how we're moving the students up a level, everybody. We're trying to raise everyone up, and I think that is so important. One exciting thing that I recognize this week, too, is the fence over at Central Park Elementary. You can see and how exciting it is to see the elementary school from the road, and I'm sure the community will appreciate that view as well. A shout out to anyone who has sophomores or juniors that are interested in study abroad or foreign travel. There's an opportunity through Rotary with Honda Japan and their sister city. And if there is interest, you can look at midlandhonda@gmail.com. And there's a March 31st deadline on that. So if anyone is interested, I encourage them to follow up. I've been watching what's going on in our U.S. Department of Education and kind of wondering what we're going to see. And right now,
proposals from the president look like 13% funding cuts for education as far as the federal education goes. So it'll be interesting to see what we end up with. Hopefully it's quite a bit more than that, but we will see. And I guess the other thing that I've been excited about is just the amount that this administration is doing with data-driven decision-making, and how that we can now identify kids that are at risk and really put into place all this growth mindset and closing the gap and being so intentional. And just a lot of credit to the administration here and what you're doing to set us up for success, because I think you'll be able to tell that with our budget as well as in every part of the organization. And the true success in that is our kids and how much they're going to improve and be ready for that next step after they graduate from this Midland Public Schools. So kudos for all the hard work.
To me, most of everything's been taken. Usually I go first and I can pick up the litter here. But
I'll stand mine for next.
Yeah. I will say, well, I think it was going to be the last one to me, but we visited the MSU STEM Center close by, and seeing the 3D printer labs was amazing. The training that they've given the staff, I forget the exact numbers, but I think that the gentleman had said they shoot for 3 or 4 leaders per school to teach those things. And so far they had trained, was it 25 to 50?
We're 24 right now.
24 for the schools coming up. So, I mean, way above and beyond what I could have expected. Touching on Scott's one-to-one technology for the elementary schools, I've volunteered the last 2 years every Tuesday at lunch running a laptop cart in the kindergarten classes. And I can honestly say that that is sorely needed, that kind of technology and the training. I'm very happy to see it. I don't know how teachers do it without having somebody in class to help get the things, the laptops out of the cart and kids logged on, and that's going to be a huge improvement. And that was all that anybody else hadn't already said.
All right. So I can't believe today's the first day of spring. We know this, as you see, Daryl, on our way here, that they have the sign-up instruction is starting Monday on I-75. So you know that it's spring. Spring sports have started. Spring break is coming up in a couple weeks, so everyone be safe. Like you had said, the Booster Bash is this Friday night. Wonderful activity. My husband and I have been sponsors ever since the first year that they had the Booster Bash, which I think was the 5th year. So it's a good time. Someone pointed out the robotics competition. I actually have the honor this year of being a judge at the robotics competition. Ooh. So please come out, and I will be there from, I think it's like 7 to 7, Friday and Saturday. So that should be exciting. Congratulations to the Shining Stars, Judy and Lori. I can vouch for Lori. I'm glad someone put one in. Last year having a senior at Dow High, she's a wonderful, wonderful job. Every Friday, like clockwork, we got an email just spelling out everything we needed to know as first-time senior parents. She walked us through the whole process, just fabulous. And then the PYP specialist presentation obviously was phenomenal. And you said a lot of great things, and that's what I was thinking, the interconnectedness between all the different subject areas, and that's so important because that's what life is. Life isn't just individual pockets of things, but it's the interconnectedness and learning to work together. So that is all I have. I will turn it over to you, Mike.
So as we progress with the construction, we need to post an auditorium manager posting. Mm-hmm. We've been preparing with that a little bit with the Midland Center for the Arts assistance. It's been a long time since we've hired an auditorium manager, and I think the job description definitely has changed. We plan on maybe having that person start on July 1. It could be August 1 as well, but in that summertime, you get a little bit of head start before the auditorium actually opens in the fall. So we're progressing nicely on that piece of it. We have also formed maybe a little bit of a partnership with Midland Center for Arts for some of the support for sound and lighting. Some of their people really don't get that much work. They have a hard time holding them. And when there's a program large enough that would need somebody to run those. We probably will partner with them going forward. So a good partnership starting between us and Midland Center for the Arts. Blended CTE alternative program, we're ready to pull the cork and begin to move forward. And so we will be doing that as we talk. So the concept is, you know, we lose, and, you know, the number changes each year, but it could be up 50 to 70 students a year, except our high schools, because they either have fallen behind or school anxiety. There's lots of issues that occur there. One of the things that we know is that CTE engages some of those kids and gets them hands-on, and we talk about Project Lead the Way, engaging kids, and some of these other programs. CTE does that as well, and our thought was that, you know, I've seen personally kids as a high school principal who couldn't make it through a six-period day academically, and then when they go to CTE and they're hands-on, they can get that academic part, come back and do their regular academic part and get through that piece of it. And so, and then instructional practices. By then, we, you know, the traditional instructional practice hasn't worked for them, so we're looking at a blended online portion of that, probably a whole lot with an adult there as they earn the capability and show that they're disciplined enough, a little less face-to-face and a little more online is the idea. But it's a development, we're developing this as we go. We'd like to engage those 50 to 70, we'd like to keep them, we'd like to get them a MPS a diploma. And so that's our goal in that program. Financially, I think any way we look at it, if we only saved half those kids, it'll break even. Actually could make us some funds, that's not really the reason to do it, but we don't wanna lose expenditures towards those kids as well. So we're gonna enter into that and hopefully be up and ready to go by the fall. Something else we may be looking at adding is some kind of gifted and talent portion again in our elementary schools, but we know that if we're doing that during the school debate and dividing our classes is not the right thing to do, and so we're going to look at an after-school gifted and talented type program for those students as well going forward. A little bit of work still to do on that, so it's an early concept, but that's something we'll continue to push for. We'll get teachers to get on board, principals on board, and explore that before we decide what that would be, and get some ownership in there. And I shared a little bit of the graduation, I don't know if I want to call it a survey, more than polling, it wasn't certainly scientific surveying, but we wanted to get a gist of it, a feel. And it came back strong, as you guys saw. I mean, almost 89% prefer to our graduation practices change. And 72% like that concept of maybe using Dow Diamond. And out of the respondents, 85.7% were current parents. It's pretty powerful, too, because they're the ones that are going to have this change of venue. I've met twice with the folks at Dow Diamond. The very initial one was, is this even possible? Would you entertain this? And it was interesting because the gentleman over there, one of them has a present junior at Midland High, and he's like thrilled that he might be the one that gets the, so that was interesting. Good feedback right off the bat from somebody right on it. I met again this last Friday with them again about potential costs set up further. And so we got some ideas. Schedule just was released for their 18 season, not real favorable to us and where we hold it, and so it could be that we could kind of be tied into a Memorial Day before you jump on that one. We could do it Thursday night before Memorial Day. Some parents would, believe it or not, Brian and I have had experience where we had to do this once before. We held one on a Friday Memorial Day, not real popular, but some parents didn't mind it because they had graduation parties on Saturday. Now those who leave town, being a Thursday, would allow them to leave town. The loons, if we do go that way, still exploring, would prefer the first year of having multiple days after to see how that worked on their field. They think they could, you know, in the future they could turn it around in a very short period of time, next day. But they want to almost have an experimental year. Well, that Memorial Day weekend would also allow them 4 or 5 days. Like every third year of their schedule, they end up playing like 2 weekends in a row at home in June. That's not the case every time, but we caught that one if we want to do it next year. So those June weekends are blocked with games where we traditionally would graduate. So we'd graduate maybe a little earlier. It might have to be on a Thursday night, like a 5:30 and 7 or 7:30 time slot to make it work. So we're still exploring it, working it. We got lots of time to get it out there, but we'll certainly keep our parents and our constituents up to date. Yeah, vested interest as well. Some really neat things he mentioned in there. They can produce this for us as well. And so parents will have access to a very high quality production of the event, stream it to parents. We could, they'd actually allow us to sell it for cheap as well to recoup some of our costs for going there. There's a possibility that they're, by the time we do that, their board in center field would be HD, he tells me. I mean, that would be a really nice viewing as well for grandparents and stuff as well who want to see Johnny up on the stage but can't see him real well there. So that holds 3,100 in the seats. That's really about what we draw. But let's say we begin to draw more. You know, some would have to be aware that it might be in a lawn seats without the best viewing, the 30 room. And then we could control that by ticketing correctly on how we control those. So lots of things to work through still. I wouldn't say we're done, but it does look like that venue is very possible to do as well. Of course, with the backups in the gym. And, you know, if we did it on a Thursday, for example, there about 10 o'clock in the morning, we got to make a call, you're in or out. And so, but I think it's worth a try as we go forward to look at another venue. Those gyms haven't worked real well. The feedback was pretty clear, hot, not comfortable seating, crowded, not easy to get in and out of.
Reason to run for the board.
Yeah, so we'll see how that goes. And then there was some of the people concerned about both of them being on the same day, same time. And so this would break that up as well. That's all I have.
All right. Thank you very much. All right. With that, we will end our meeting, 8:41. Thank you, everybody.